support we've received from the state of South Carolina. We've had a great team of employees here, great support from the state. And with that, we've been able to put additional investment to this site. We've put additional about $60+ million of investment in our site to help us improve the quality of our product, the quantity that we can make to ship around the world, and importantly, to generate great jobs. So we've been very pleased with the team here in South Carolina and the support we've received from the state. So thank you very much. I'll turn it over. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Papa. I'm Sam Condouris, have the privilege of leading South Carolina's Life Science Economic Development Organization, SC Bio, and very, very pleased to be here. What an honor it is for us to have you here and members of your executive team assembled in Greenville on a beautiful spring day. Certain corporate brands exude confidence, quality, trustworthiness, and innovation, and are highly sought after by consumers and citizens all over the country and the world, and Bausch & Lomb is such a brand. Global, iconic, ever-evolving, constantly committed to continuous improvement, and a name recognized by everyone. So Mr. Papa, again, welcome, and I often talk about being a visual person. I would say that no sense that human beings are gratefully endowed with is more precious than our sight and vision. All of us are grateful for the technology, innovation, advanced manufacturing excellence that results in products produced right here in Greenville that protect the eyes of millions of us every single day of our lives. We're so proud that Bausch Health has such a significant strategic presence here in Greenville and South Carolina, and you've been part of the fabric of the life science industry in this state since 1983. 38 years, which is just amazing, producing some of your top global products at this location, investing millions of dollars in this community many times over, providing high quality jobs and careers for hundreds of South Carolinians, and being an incredibly important part of the life science industry, now recognized as the fastest growing segment of our state's innovation economy, which everyone will hear a little more about this morning. So Mr. Papa, Mr. Schrader, Mr. Conti, Mr. Asherin, heartfelt thanks to each of you and all of your outstanding colleagues and associates here for your demonstrated commitment to our state and for being a long-standing pillar of this vibrant community, and to Bausch for being one of the pioneering biotech companies that chose the Palmetto State long before this particular industry had become so entrenched here. You took a chance on us very early, and we're extremely grateful for that, and remain absolutely committed to your long-term success and prosperity. In addition to celebrating Bausch Health and its leadership team and associates today, I'm also pleased to recognize a few important guests who contribute so much to SC Bio's bold statewide mission to build, advance, innovate, and grow the life science industry in South Carolina in tandem and coordination with our awesome South Carolina Department of Commerce. I will say that nobody energizes this industry and its forward movement in South Carolina, inspiring and invigorating everyone around her, including me, like our amazing South Carolina Bio Board Chair, Mrs. Lou Kennedy, CEO and owner of world-class Nephron Pharmaceuticals in Columbia. Lou, please be recognized, and thank you for all of your contributions to the state. I know it was important for you to be here today to celebrate the success of one of your fellow industries. We also have representatives from the offices of Congressman Timmons, Senator Scott, and I would also like to recognize, I see him in the back, being very humble and modest, but Mr. Mark Ferris, President, CEO of Greenville Area Development Corporation, who so competently leads and advances Greenville County's economic development efforts. Thanks, Mark, for being here to celebrate one of your world-class existing industries. And now, I have the distinct honor of again introducing the 117th governor of the state of South Carolina, the Honorable Henry Dargan McMaster. Governor McMaster laid a foundation for this important day with a proclamation he made recently in February, which was a centerpiece of SC Bio's record-breaking life science industry annual conference, which had almost 700 participants from 9 countries that week. At that time, I had the privilege of sharing many details about his amazing and signature career, which has been highlighted by powerful contributions he's made as Attorney General, Lieutenant Governor, and so many other exceptional roles. But there is no role that he was more built for and born for than serving as Governor and Chief Executive of the state of South Carolina. Beyond his vision, intellect, and bold leadership, what makes him an amazing leader for this state is his heartfelt love and passion for South Carolina. It comes through authentically in everything he does, and it is literally fuel for South Carolina's stunning rise as one of the most prosperous and booming states in America under his leadership. So thank you, Governor, for being here today and making this great event happen. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. And those words are right. It is stunning. What South Carolina is doing is stunning all around the world. And Lou, you know that. Lindsey Graham, you know that. Mr. Schrader, Mr. Papa, you know that. And there's more to come. I'm here today to remind us all that we're taking another giant step into our very, very bright future here in South Carolina. No place in the country is the future brighter than it is here. Marshall Long has been one of our state's most successful biotech pharma companies for many years, employing hundreds of wonderful South Carolinians in high quality jobs, and there are more to come. It's companies like Bosch and Lomb that have helped propel South Carolina into the emerging life science hub that it is today and made it a choice destination for life science industries and companies, as Sam Condura said. The life sciences sector is one of the fastest growing industries in our state's economy, with an annual impact, an economic impact, of over $12 billion and has created more than 800 firms and employs over 43,000 professionals in our state. To recognize this remarkable success, I recently issued an official proclamation where Sam was there, Lindsey was there, declaring February 15th through 19th South Carolina Bio Life Science Week in South Carolina. The COVID-19 pandemic has clearly illustrated why no single nation or state, no nation like China or others, should be the sole source or should have a monopoly on the production of essential medicines and medical supplies like personal protective equipment and others. Because essential goods and products were and still are disproportionately manufactured outside of our country, in countries like China and in other states, South Carolina and other states were forced to compete against one another for limited domestic supplies of personal protective equipment that many of us, all of you, are wearing right now. We had one shipment that Boeing went and took their Dream Lifter and brought back hundreds of thousands of masks that were paid for by Prisma and donated to the state of South Carolina months ago. We were literally in a bidding war. We had meetings every morning, assembled meetings, to determine where and when we would be able to get personal protective equipment and other things at the beginning of this pandemic. And ladies and gentlemen, we were literally, our state government was literally competing with other states around the country for scarce protective equipment. And we were getting, most of it was coming from outside of the United States, on sometimes a very fragile transportation line. But all that has taught us a valuable lesson. In fact, to our competitors in China and other places, I would say, to paraphrase the prophetic words of Admiral Yamamoto after the bombing of Pearl Harbor, he said that, and I refer to this virus, which came from China, this has awakened a sleeping giant and filled him with a terrible resolve. And because of that resolve, we see states and all around our country, and particularly this state, taking extra measures to be sure that this does not happen again. We must be secure in our own borders in order for our people to prosper. We are confident that South Carolina can compete with any foreign nation and any other state for new jobs and investment, and that includes domestic research, development, and production of essential medicines and medical supplies. Today I've issued an executive order directing our Department of Commerce, in coordination with the South Carolina Biotechnology Industry Organization, known as SC Bio, which Sam heads, to undertake a new and exciting pharmaceutical manufacturing recruitment initiative. The Department of Commerce will prioritize and enhance their already ongoing economic development and recruitment efforts by identifying, encouraging, and incentivizing pharmaceutical and medical supply manufacturers, both international and domestic, to locate research, development, and production facilities within South Carolina. This will include developing and executing international and domestic marketing campaigns that promote the state of South Carolina as a global, a national, and a global leader in this exciting, innovative sector. Also, Commerce will facilitate, assist, and incentivize growth, expansion, investment, and employment opportunities at existing businesses and industries located within our state. Commerce will also identify and advocate for statutory and regulatory changes or enhancements to the state's existing economic development mechanisms necessary for new business and industry development or expansion in South Carolina. And finally, my executive order directs all state agencies or departments involved in the procurement of essential and important medicines, medical services, or medical supplies to prioritize buying made in South Carolina products from manufacturers and suppliers with operations located in our state. So again, I say this is a great day for South Carolina, and by successfully recruiting pharmaceutical and medical manufacturing companies to invest, locate, and expand in South Carolina, we will have ready and reliable access to the critical resources and supplies we will need for good health in South Carolina and what we may need for future public health emergencies should they arrive. Thank you very much for what you're doing. On behalf of this presentation, on behalf of our state seal, on behalf of approximately 5 million proud, happy South Carolinians, we ask you to accept this gift as a token of our appreciation for your work and that of your fine company, Bausch & Lomb. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Governor. We're excited for this bold executive order and all that it stands for. And I will tell you that SC Bio will do everything in its power, shoulder to shoulder with the Department of Commerce, regional, local economic development teams across South Carolina to aggressively follow your lead and execute this directive with all of our creativity, imagination, and might, with the goal of making the Palmetto State the most fertile and desired place in America for onshoring the pharmaceutical and life science industries in this new era of economic development. And when I speak of onshoring and repatriating this incredible industry with triple the research and development spend of all others, and that is focused on human health and life, it's important to recognize that the federal government will also have a critical role in assisting states like South Carolina to rebuild America's independence in the production of all conceivable life science products and technologies, from pharmaceuticals and API to every manner of PPE. We have no greater champion for our state in Washington than Senator Lindsey Graham. He's been a powerhouse for the advancement of economic development and innovation in South Carolina for 30 years. So again, thanks for the humbling proclamation, and Senator.
Thank you. Well, this is a big deal. About a little over a year ago, our nation was turned upside down. This is the third pandemic to come out of China, and I'm afraid it won't be the last. China's practices need to change. They need to be more transparent. We need to find out how this happened in China, what they did and did not do, and get to the bottom of it so it will not happen again. But you'd have to be pretty naive to believe this will be the last time we were being faced with this. So here today is an important step by the state of South Carolina to lead and to get ahead of a problem. So I would encourage every governor in the United States to do what Governor McMaster did here today. Make it a priority of each state to develop PPE equipment to make us less dependent on China and Henry, as many things that are good in modern America. It started here in South Carolina under your leadership. Congratulations. So what can I do at the federal level? We're spending a lot of money, and some of it makes sense, some of it doesn't to me. But tax credits to develop PPE in the United States would be smart in my view. This is a great healthcare facility. The workforce here is outstanding. You have to make a product very specific and very high quality. This is really a feat of manufacturing excellence. So what I want to do to help Governor McMaster is to tell any company that if you get in the PPE business, gloves, masks, and all the equipment we need to deal with pandemics now and in the future, we'll give you tax credits akin to what we do for wind and solar in the energy arena. We have dramatically expanded clean energy by creating tax advantages for people to go in that business. We're incentivizing people to buy electric cars. That's good for the economy, that's good for the environment. I'd like to replicate that in the area of PPE. So Henry, as you try to focus on recruiting these businesses, I'm going to be your partner in Washington incentivizing people to go into this space. Here are the numbers. At the start of the pandemic, 90% of all protective equipment that our doctors and nurses and healthcare professionals relied upon to take care of us during COVID was made in China, a single country. 72% of all the medical compounds, Lou, that go into making drugs are made outside this country. Governor McMaster has made a decision that I think will pay dividends to this state long after our time is up. By focusing on this at the top of the political food chain, the governor of South Carolina, he is telling everybody in America, South Carolina is open and ready to do business in the area of bioscience, and I'll be your partner in Washington. To the employees here, God bless you. You make us all proud.
Thank you, Senator Graham, as always, and we're going to be dependent on you in D.C. Governor McMaster, thank you again for making this industry a cornerstone of your administration and putting a lot of wind in our sails, as we say. We are determined to work hard, and there is a lot in the pipeline right now. South Carolina is a place that is being looked at by a lot of global companies, and we are grateful that companies like Bausch Health, Nephron Pharmaceuticals have created a foundation and an ecosystem that is thriving, growing, and is loaded with talent, assets, resources that are all going to be brought to bear to make this a reality. So I think there's a lot of announcements, capital investment, new jobs that are going to be coming, and the incredible diversification that this industry brings to our state is something that is going to echo for a lot of years, I think, from today's executive order. So thank you, sir. I would thank again all the executives of Bausch for hosting us today and everybody for coming. We're going to have a couple of photo ops with speakers and the executive team of Bausch. Please stick around, and the governor is going to get a tour of the facility. So thank you again, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you. do it like where we're not looking directly at what we were just shooting.
That's fine. I mean, you guys, you guys tell me.
Cool.
Well, let's think about it. Yeah, and for
took a long time. I was actually on the advisory board when they put that initial training program together. When I was in Greenville, North Carolina, they started the program at one of the local community colleges in the county. I was on the advisory board for the curriculum development there, and they eventually moved up to the Biotech Center. And then when they graduated the program, they would actually come to the facility that I ran, and I would give them tours to say, here, this is it, or they were in their last courses right now. Here's something that you've been teaching, the practical aspects of these things. Here's the day-to-day of what that looks like. Seeing the practical side of it, that's good. People were okay, you teach them again, right? But they really don't understand the realities, right? The implications of what they're doing, we try to teach them. I always try to talk to people about the things you don't think about in day-to-day life that you have to think about what we do, right? I always tell people when I gave them plant tours and works in the pharmacy area. What we make is products. It's just like making a recipe in the kitchen. But how many of you, when you pull that out and out, it says use 3 large eggs? If you look in the refrigerator and it says you have extra large eggs, how many of you even think about the difference between large and extra large? Nobody. But we do. Just that kind of thing.
Here comes. Just a reminder, all on top. You guys said you had no off topics, and then we'll get to yours at the next event.
Okay.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Okie dokie.
Thank you for talking to us.
Happy to do it. Y'all were here for that?
Oh,
okay.
Yeah. Happy opening day to
you. Yeah, thank you. They'll see you back there. They've got it. They organized. This working is quite something. This was built in 83. I don't know about this part, but parts of it were built in 1983. So Bausch and Lomb is one of the first such life science biotech companies to come to South Carolina, and we are confident there'll be more, and that's the purpose of my executive order, to make it clear what we're doing to all the state agencies as well as the people and those that are interested around the country and around the world, that we're open for business. We have a lot of these kinds of businesses already. I got a list of them somewhere. Anyway, we have about 800 in total, and we never closed. We didn't lock down like they did in other states. So we had a very light, very, very careful touch, and as a result, a lot of other states are having to dig up out of holes. They're having to borrow money to make ends meet. We don't have those problems. We're launching, and we're moving quickly, and we want everyone to know that this type of industry, because of all the reasons, the scarcity of medicines and products and personal protective equipment, all that we had to get from other countries, notably China, is an unacceptable situation to be in. It bears on our health, our safety, our national security, and everything in between.
Talk a little bit about the incentives you want to put in place to draw these companies.
Well, we have our Department of Commerce has a standard approach to businesses and industries that want to come to the state or that want to expand. part of which includes the incentives of what they call Ready SC, which is a part of our, is part of commerce, but also part of the technical college system, where we can train employees for jobs that are not even here yet, for careers that are yet to be built. And we can send a team to go to other countries, other places, other states, to explain to them the what we have here in South Carolina, the collaboration that we have among the research universities, the technical schools, and everything in between, as well as certain tax incentives and things of that nature. So we want to, I've asked Commerce to look at all their packages, all their approaches, and be sure that we are fine-tuned for a lot of things, including this life science industry, which is so important to our future, to our well-being, and to our national security.
And, you know, around just up and down 85, I think you got North American Rescue, like right across the street, you've got another company that that creates emergency response bags for first responders and stuff. Yeah. Is this kind of, you know, now that we've kind of done so much with the auto industry, is this kind of where the focus has become?
Well, we're not going to take our focus off the auto industry because we're good at it. We build things. We build passenger planes in North Charleston and fighter jets in Greenville and everything in between with BMW, Volvo, and Mercedes. And we're the place to be for a lot of reasons, one of which is we never have and never will close down a manufacturing plant as they did in other states and all sorts of things, including churches and things of that nature. Factory. A bill is, I've been urging the schools to open back up for months now, and many of them have, but not enough. And the legislature, the Senate passed a bill yesterday and sent it to the House to require the schools to open up. The schools are moving a little too slow. Should have been open by now, but we are open. We're open for business. We have the technology. We have the capacity. We have the research universities, the technical colleges, the four-year, the two-year. We can train, educate, and prepare people for the investment that we want these companies to make in South Carolina, because this is the best place there is to do business.
And are you also hoping that this will help, this executive order will also help during hurricane seasons? Charleston earthquake happens again or something.
Well, we have other things we're doing for that. Of course, that will provide needed equipment, protective equipment, medicine, things of those natures for any kind of emergency. But we also have our Floodwater Commission that is studying exactly that, made recommendations, and they are being implemented now.
And I guess what do you want the people of South Carolina to know the most about this executive order?
About this? Is that South Carolina is looking to the future. We are taking yet another giant step into the future for the health and prosperity of our people. We are the best place in the country to live, work, raise a family, and do business. We want everybody to know it, because that's the kind of place we want to be. We know that the economy, the education, and the environment, when you do those things correctly, each supports the other. We're doing them correctly, and we want our people to be prosperous and happy and healthy.
Last question, if there is one. You guys good?
I'm good.
Cool.
Okay, thank you very much.
ahead and get started. My name is David Armistead with DC Blocks, and on behalf of our company, I'd like to welcome all of you to the groundbreaking of the DC Blocks Greenville Data Center. So thank you all for coming. To get started, I'll give you a quick overview of what we're going to do today. We're going to have some brief remarks by several speakers, and then we're going to have a traditional photo shoot with the shovels, which are lined up over here behind me. There'll also be an opportunity to meet with some of the DC Blocks leadership and our esteemed guests and talk with the media, so please stick around after the speeches and after we do the photo shoot. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker. This is Jeff Uphues. He's been our Chief Executive Officer since 2017. He's led the company in redefining the corporate strategy, raised essential funding, and has executed our plan to build data centers in growing cities across the southeastern United States. Jeff is a technology industry veteran that understands that this economy of this century will be driven and indeed transformed by new digital infrastructure, including data centers. It is my pleasure to introduce Jeff Uphues.
Well, thank you, David. It's great to see everybody out here today. I'm glad we're blessed with a wonderful sunny day. A little cooler than what I had anticipated, but it beats trying to do some of this yesterday, where it was a torrential rainstorm. So we're excited this day is finally here to announce the start of our construction in bringing the first multi-tenant Tier 3 design data center to the great state of South Carolina. Governor McMaster, Senator Graham, Mayor White, Ambassador Wilkins, and the many distinguished guests, we're honored and humbled for your attendance here today. On behalf of our team at DC Blocks, we're very grateful for everyone who made this day possible. All of you have collectively opened your arms in welcoming us to your great state, and we've witnessed firsthand the heart and soul of the community across your state. We truly have experienced firsthand why people call Greenville the friendliest city in the United States. Many of you here today played a critical role in helping bring DC Blocks to the market. Over the last 5 months since our announcement, we've strived to understand the culture of doing business in the upstate and what challenges exist for your businesses to operate and thrive in this digital world. We've learned their challenges, how to reliably secure and protect and scale and connect digital infrastructure to the cloud services that are available today and to all their customers. Equally important, we've been fortunate enough in getting to know so many leaders on both a business and a personal level. I have to tell you, the people in the businesses of South Carolina deeply care about working with firms that go out of their way to make a difference in their communities across the state. And they love doing business with people they like, they know, and they trust to collectively work together to make South Carolina a great place to work and live. Without question, this is why we believe the upstate and South Carolina are one of the best places to do business anywhere in the country. On this site behind me, DC Blocks, upon full completion, our data center will feature 6 distinct data center halls with over 54,000 square feet of data center space, with a full critical load capable of supporting 18 megawatts of power. If you think of 18 megawatts of power, think of it, for every megawatt you can power roughly about 3,000 homes. So if you start adding those up and looking at the capacity of what this facility will have, it'll be very, very unique in supporting the needs of government and other local customers. The data center will be used to serve needs related to businesses with secure office space. This secure office space will allow customers to come in and support their computing infrastructure while doing so in a safe and secure manner. This new data center will create new high-paying jobs to the community, along with an expected investment over the course of the next 5 to 7 years, approaching $200 million between us and our customers. The projected capital investments are the single largest amount reported by the Greenville Area Development Corporation in at least the last 5 years. So for that, we're thankful to the GADC, Mark Ferris and team, You guys did a remarkable job for us in helping attract us and bring us here to the market. Greenville and the upstate region are a vibrant, entrepreneurial-driven community that will greatly benefit from DC Blocks' presence in the state. As we know, we can help drive the knowledge economy, which is now part of our everyday lives. From your robust manufacturing, to your automotive tech sector, to the growing life sciences and healthcare communities, DC Blocks is confident we can help enable the digital economy across the state through this facility. We know we can help accelerate the rapidly growing and thriving ecosystem in this life sciences industry of the Palmetto State as a top new destination for expansion, onshoring, and repatriation of the pharmaceutical and API industries by working closely with SC Bio and Sam Conduras. DC Blocks will add immense value and power to the life sciences ecosystem to support their bold initiatives, which will require robust digital infrastructure that can be housed in this building. We also know the impact this center can have on city, county, state, federal government entities that require robust security, reliability, compliance-driven infrastructure to power the communities, our communities, for decades to come. It's our purpose at DC Blocks to serve locally and connect globally on behalf of our customers. Serving locally to DC Blocks means we're a company that gets involved, we stay involved, as it's part of our DNA. We serve local, act local, commit our time to the community with our calendars and our checkbooks as we strive to make a difference. This is not just with the business services we deliver, but our total engagement to serve the needs of the entire market. The other half of our vision of connecting globally to DC Blocks means we will provide the critical infrastructure to our customers that connects our customers to the world. We create this connectivity system, or ecosystem like we refer to, where all types of content can be distributed at the speed of light through the facility that will be sitting behind me. We provide direct connect private connections to cloud services like Amazon and our partners at Google. We do this with Microsoft, and will be trusted by many of the 5G providers and network carriers and government entities to deliver the types of services that power our economy. We commit to you that we'll do our part to continue to embrace the community, to our new neighbors, and to the businesses of South Carolina. With our new technology campus you'll see behind me, South Carolina and the upstate and Greenville will be enabled with a modern, state-of-the-art, highly secure, certified facility that can be an economic engine to bring more cloud technologies, more life sciences, and improves everybody's digital experiences throughout the upstate. Thank you again today for coming. It is a privilege to call Greenville our home for our new facility. It's now my great pleasure to introduce the Governor of South Carolina, Henry McMaster.
Thank you, Jeff. I want to thank you for those beautiful, insightful words, and for one reason among others, you covered everything. There's very little for the rest of us to say. That'll keep us from freezing to death while we're under this tent. All the sun's out there. Thank you. I read somewhere that it said when you go into a store, in a grocery store, and you pick up one of those little birthday cards and open it up and it sings happy birthday to you, that you're holding in your hand more computer power than existed in the world in 1945 and 1950. Things have really changed in a hurry. Knox White, great city. Dan Adams, great city. Conduras. Sam's daddy now, friends for a long, he's a great man. We sure do miss him. But this is, Greenville's come along so well, and I'm glad to see that DC Blocks is focusing on the part of the world where the growth and the brains really are concentrating. You've selected South Carolina, Georgia, Tennessee, and Alabama. Couldn't be any better. Greenville has gone from textile to tech in no time at all, and from where I sit and from what I see with the kind of team that we have, where everybody knows everybody, the sky's the limit right here. And I want to remind everybody that's listening, we did not lock down. This is a no lockdown state. We kept our economy going, and we are taking off now. Others are backfilling, borrowing money, going broke, and everything in between. not us here. And we're ready for you. And this is the kind of thing that's going to take us into the future. We appreciate it. Thank you very much. Now, on behalf of about 5 million proud, happy South Carolinians, most of whom are fairly warm at this moment, I want to give you this as a flag of the South State motto, and we appreciate your presence and look forward to working with you.
Thank you very much. We're really proud to be here.
Thank you.
Our next speaker really needs no introduction around these parts. He may be the smartest man in the tent because he's sitting in the sunshine, in the warmth. But today we're honored to have Senator Lindsey Graham.
I don't know, it's a pretty weak tent if I'm the smartest man in it. So I don't believe that. The smart people are building stuff, right, Henry? And so this has been a heck of a day. We started over at Bosch with a bioscience executive order by Governor McMaster that South Carolina is going to get into the life science, pharmaceutical manufacturing, PPE manufacturing. When we started this pandemic about a little over a year ago, 90% of all PPE equipment was made in China. We're going to stop that. South Carolina is going to lead the way. The reason you picked Greenville is because we're growing. The reason we're growing is because Marist is a hell of a place to live. It really is the most vibrant community I think I've seen develop in South Carolina since the mid-70s. I used to come over here a lot in the 70s to go to wrestling, and you had to run to your car. Greenville is really just a model of what can happen if people work together. We've got our county council chairman. Willis, thank you for coming today. The reason people come here is because it's a good place to do business. It is friendly. We have good schools. We have a great workforce and a tax structure that you can be successful. So we're glad you chose us. We hope you'll grow. Data is the lifeline of the digital age, and the digital age is going to rocket and skyrocket here soon. I don't know if I make it to Strom's age, but in the next 50 years, most cars on the road are going to be electric. Most cars on the road are going to be self-driving, autonomous vehicles. What do they have in common? Sensors and data. So you are the future, and we're so glad you chose South Carolina. Henry, thank you for being a great governor, business-friendly. Knox County Council, thank you for making this a place not only to do business but to raise a family. God bless you all, and I'm going to get back in the sun. Thank you.
As we were exploring the Greenville area as a potential site for our next data center, we met a number of outstanding supporters. This includes County Council Chairman Willis Meadows and GADC President and CEO Mark Ferris, both of whom are here today. So thank you for joining us. We also met a very welcoming mayor and friend who understands that data centers are and core infrastructure are essential to growing cities like Greenville, much like the highway system of the last century. I'm honored to introduce our next guest, Mayor Knox White.
Oh, this feels a lot better, Governor. Yeah. It's a great day to be here, and so many appropriate things have been said, but I do want to kind of share a backstory, if you will. When Jeff first arrived in Greenville, it was one of the most fascinating dinners I've ever had with prospects and such, and I mean that sincerely, and I've told him that, and Governor hinted to a minute ago, because I was told that I was going to meet somebody whose company has done perhaps the deepest dig research into communities in the Southeast of anyone who's come through here, in that they had crunched numbers, done heavy-duty research, and ranked the cities of the Southeast, Raleigh, Winston-Salem, Chattanooga. And behind that was hard data about everything about their local economy, their education, their economic development potentials, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But then Jeff had done something else. He not only had the hard data that which he, again, painstakingly had put together, very impressive, almost like a secret document, but he'd done something else. He decided, you know, let's hit the road and actually visit these cities. And something interesting happened, and that was the subject of the dinner that night. some of those cities that looked so good on the paper, on the rankings, when he actually went to those cities for a week or so, he found out that, number two on the list really wasn't so great, or the reality check wasn't there. And so it's through that process that Greenville, South Carolina went from kind of a middling number to way up at top of number one. And he said it wasn't just the data that you can read, and that was a lesson he learned after he'd spent so much time and money on that. It was something else more elusive. It was the vision in the community. It was the culture of the community, the working together that some of y'all talked about a moment ago, the business-friendly nature, just the leaders they met in the community, and that changed everything. And he told the great story. I'm not going to give away who changed places with who. Let's just say again, some of those people at the top fell to the bottom, and some of the bottom got to the top. What a great lesson for all of us in that. He did that kind of work. He got people here. And that's another lesson we all know, that when we get people here, we actually get them here, and they walk the streets of downtown Greenville. They see the community. It changes everything in perceptions. So great lesson for us. But thank you, Jeff, for all of that. It certainly is true. This is the infrastructure of the future. So honestly, as railroads were to the 19th century and 20th century, the interstate highway system and everything that came from that, this is the 21st century. Essential infrastructure that's going to make all the difference. It's right here in the upstate of South Carolina and right here in Greenville, so we're really proud of it. Jeff, I'm going to give you a little gift, too. We have this little motto code, yeah, that Greenville, because there's so many darn Greenvilles in the country, like something like 50 states and there's 46 Greenvilles or something. So we have this, yeah, that Greenville, and you get the personal, yeah, that Greenville.
There we go.
Nobody means it more than this guy. I know you will. I know you will.
Right. Well, DC Blocks appreciate your attendance and support, and we thank you all for joining us today. We consider it an honor and a privilege that you took the time to be with us. We're about to step over here and do our photo shoot with the shovels, but again, please feel free to stick around afterwards to mingle and talk to the DC Blocks leadership as well as our special guests. When I call your name, if you would, follow Follow Bill over here, and we'll step into the sunshine and the warmth. So, Governor McMaster, Senator Graham, Mayor White, Ambassador Wilkins, Max Metcalf, and also from DC Blocks, Jeff Uphues, Mark Mason, Ted Hassel, and Jeff Williams. Thank y'all.
Thank you. free.
Point discipline right here.
Ted, I think you're supposed to go shovel that back over on the other side of the fence now.
Yeah, let the building begin.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you?
Oh, I grabbed it. Yeah, I had to run over there, but
I was going to go get it.
Don't even worry about it. Don't even worry about it. Thank you, though.
Exciting day for DC Blocks as we christen the groundbreaking for our new Tier 3 data center in Greenville. It's a remarkable day for the upstate, a remarkable day way for us to be here in this community. This community is just growing by leaps and bounds. The amount of technology infrastructure that is here, we know we can help support them through the efforts of what we'll do with this building. And certainly every business across the state of South Carolina could benefit by having DC Blocks here. So exciting day for us. Great that we had such a wonderful day out here. Really excited that the governor and Lindsey Graham showed up, the mayor. It just says a lot about the community and what we've been able to do here and what we will do. It's fully supported by the whole community.
And how do you feel about getting involved to support the local communities outside of business?
Well, DC Blocks is a company that we really have one purpose, which is to serve locally and connect globally on behalf of our customers. Serving locally for us has a whole nother meaning. We get involved, we stay involved, we're involved in the community to help causes. One of them we're really, really passionate about is how can we help technology, especially helping stop the digital divide that exists with underprivileged kids, parents, schools, and other areas, that we use technology. It's part of every day of our lives, and we know that by serving locally and connecting globally in the organization, by being involved and staying involved, we can make a difference.
Very good.
What makes this place so special to y'all? I mean, you said you went all over the country. I mean, Grant, we heard a lot about that up there, but like, why data here as opposed to somewhere that's more like the surrounding areas of Atlanta or something along those lines?
Data exists everywhere. And when you're existing everywhere, I mean, every single thing that you do as a person today, whether it's your television set, your mobile phone, your computer, your laptop, your iPad, or whatever you're carrying, it's all driven by data. And data is growing at an alarming rate. So when you think of what businesses are doing, you think of what the state is doing, you think of what's happening with automotive research here, you think of what's happening with SC Bio and the bio institutes and the technology. Data is compounding year over year, month over month, day over day, and it needs to be closer to where it's being consumed. So when you look at areas of the country, this is an area between in the upstate of around 1.4 to 1.5 million people that did not have any tier 3 rated infrastructure anywhere, frankly, in the state, let alone in this market. And so we seek out growing markets that have a need to help computing resources and technology have homes for their equipment. I mean, we have to store this in very, very complex ways, and we do so through a facility like what you'll find behind me. It was, when you look at South Carolina, it's just a great, it's a great opportunity for us to come in and help the businesses and be used as almost a recruiting engine to come in here for attracting other businesses and economic development.
And what type of jobs, aside from the construction, of course, what type of jobs is your company looking to fill?
Yeah, initially we'll have about a half a dozen jobs that come into the market. A good way to think of a center like what we're building is a cabinet of equipment. And this facility will house roughly around 1,200 to 1,500 cabinets of equipment. A cabinet of equipment equates to the tax base of one $50,000 a year job. So if we can house 1,200 to 1,500 cabinets of computers here, and each one generates property tax, sales tax dollars, and others, it really is equivalent to about a $50,000 a year job. So you could look at it and say, hey, we may only initially have a half a dozen employees, up to maybe a dozen employees in here, but it'll have the impact in the community of upwards of 1,000 to 1,500 or more jobs just in the tax dollars it creates, without putting any burden or any burden on the infrastructure or for school systems or anything else. It's a great tax generator and a great way to bring more clients and more customers here.
And so with the building of this, does this mean basically everybody in Greenville is going to have just blinding internet speed, that kind of stuff? What exactly is like a tier 3 system?
Tier 3 system really has to deal with, is it concurrently maintainable? Can you withstand power outages? Can you withstand long periods of time where maybe the weather is bad and you're dealing with rolling brownouts and things with the power industry? How do you secure it? I mean, this facility will be fenced all the way around. It'll look a little bit like a hardened, almost like,